Right. Hi, I'm Dr. Stefana Pescher, the country doc, coming to you live here from North Stonington, Connecticut. We have Dr. Christine Schlichting, an amazing psychologist, here with us tonight, as well as her associate, Erica Wilcox, also of Hopewell Health Solutions. And we are introducing our new community health initiative, Wings of Wellness.
So the mission of this program is to get education out into the community to really help people understand the tools of transformation and how to move their lives forward. We find in the practice that we end up saying the same things over and over again to people. So we really want to create more of a community-based wellness program where people can benefit from a lot of the tools that we've learned that help people move forward in more of a community setting and to really start opening up honest conversations about tough topics.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Yeah.
So Erica, we invite you to come up and take it away.
So hi everyone, welcome. Thanks for coming this evening. Everyone's lives are pretty busy, and so it really says a lot about you taking the time to be here for yourself or for somebody in your life. And so I'll be walking you through bits and pieces for today. So I was driving up here today and was really kind of going back and forth of, well, what do you say? How do you start difficult conversations? And how do you make difficult conversations inspiring? And how do you reach people? And my hope is that if at least one person can leave here today with a little bit more insight, a little bit more knowledge, a little bit more empowerment, then I've done my job. And so my name is Erica Wilcox. I'm an independent practitioner out of Southington, Connecticut, and I mainly do trauma recovery work. And it's something that truly is my life's work, coming from a place myself of being a trauma survivor and working with that resilience, and part of that, part of me making meaning out of that is helping others recover as well. And little piece by piece. So thank you for coming this evening. So all the hustle and bustle of everything, I know I get a little anxious when things are running late. I don't know if other people do too. I'm like, ready to go. So you may not be able to hear, so I'll talk really loud. This is what it sounds like. Okay. So what we'll start with is, and you can, if you want to, a hand on your heart, hand on your core, your belly area, and a lot of times society conditions people to suck in their stomach. I want you to do the opposite now. And so when we breathe in, the belly's gonna go out, so you're filling a balloon. So if you watch my hand, right? And then out. You're experts already. So we're going to start with three of those. And on the exhale, I'm going to ring the chime and try to draw the breath out through the sound of the chime. So whatever your comfort level is, okay? So breathing in and exhale. Great. Another breath in and exhale. And a final breath in and exhale. Feels a little better, huh? So, either you're here today because you yourself have experienced something stressful or you would categorize as traumatic, maybe somebody you know, maybe you're just curious, whatever the reason is, again, I thank you for being here, and I want you to know that
trauma recovery is possible. So doing the work that I do, my clients, my family ask me all the time, like, how do you do this? How do you hear really difficult, messy stuff every single day? And they kind of wait in anticipation of, like, don't hear the answer. And I do it because people get better. And I firmly believe in the potential and the resiliency of the human spirit to rise above painful situations. And so trauma recovery is a process. I'm going to walk you through that and outline it. We can go to the next one. Oh, maybe it's the computer that we... No? That's readable, right? Okay. So, goals for today is...
Flip the mic.
Oh,
there you go.
This?
Just flip it so it's facing you.
On the table.
So it catches your voice.
Oh.
There you go.
Thank you. Yeah, I don't need to hold it. Okay. So... goals for today, so to gain a greater understanding of what trauma and most people have heard of PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, what those are, I find a lot of people hear the word trauma and it feels really scary, or they either really connect with it or they think, oh, that's not me. So I really want to create some awareness around that. To learn the connection between trauma, power, and abuse. This is specifically with regards to relationships and how that plays out. And to learn three new coping skills. Actually, this is a bonus plan because the first one's already down. We have three more to go, so I should change that to four. And so we'll have little breaks along the way to kind of lighten things up, talk about some stuff that may be a little deep, and then put some things into action. And then an action plan for healing moving forward. What does that look like for you or your loved one? If you have questions along the way, please don't hesitate to ask. I want this to be really interactive and laid back and just as if we were having coffee in my office and having a conversation. So we can go to the next one. Thanks. So the symbol, I love this. Is anyone familiar with this? The symbol, Chinese symbol for crisis, also means danger and opportunity put together. So these two symbols put together mean crisis, danger and opportunity. And so it's looking at things in a way of, do you want life's challenges, do you want the stressors to deplete you and rob you and take from you and delete from your life? Or do you want to take from that? What can we learn from this? What can we use this to, what can you use it to fuel you moving forward? When we look around, it seems that our world is full, is always in a state of crisis, and it's full of suffering. But, you know, everywhere we look, we can see pain and devastation, and that's, I think, the part, you know, to be human, part of it means that there's suffering involved. But although the world is full of suffering, it's awful, also full of overcoming it. And so we need to make a clear distinction first about what's natural suffering, and then suffering that we as human beings create. And in this, I'll invite you throughout the rest of our, well, we're not an hour and a half, right, time today, I'll challenge you to check in with yourself. Have little checkpoints about what you're feeling in your body, what you're feeling in your mind, because our instinct when we're exposed to pain or we're thinking about things that may be difficult is to pull away. It's like a hot stove. We're biologically programmed to pull away. So this is an opportunity and a safe way to kind of lean in and be really curious. So again, we need to make a clear distinction between what's natural suffering and in what's created suffering. Can we click it again? So we can't avoid suffering from natural disasters, for example. We experience natural pain during the normal course of life, being born, having a child,
not sleeping because of said child. I have a two-year-old who does not sleep, so I'm still, I have a little, you know, peer relationships from being lost. Even if that's, you know, it's a healthy relationship, it ends, it runs its course, right? Ending or starting a job, getting an education, building a career, death of a loved one, something we can't avoid. These are all losses. They're all kind of forms of suffering. So these passages can be painful in our life, but they're also the foundation of our identities. If you think about the stuff that's happened in your life, who's made you who you are today, it was not sunny days. It was not the days where you're like, yeah, life is good, and all the green lights happen when you're driving. It's the tough stuff. And so that's what I mean about really kind of digging deep and using that as fuel. So when you think about trauma, I looked at a lot of different definitions, and I run a lot of women's trauma recovery and empowerment groups, and I always throw this out there. We do this within the first session about how do we define it, because knowledge is
power.
The more you know, the more you can do. You ever feel like, oh, I feel something, it doesn't feel right, but I don't know what it is. Maybe it's something medical, maybe it's something emotional, and someone says, oh, you have XYZ, right? Oh, that's a migraine headache you have. If you didn't know that's what that was, I'm in this pain, I have no idea what it is, and once someone says this is what it is, then you can use that power and that knowledge to move forward. So, trauma occurs when any external threat overwhelms a person's internal and external positive coping skills. So it creates a disconnect on two levels. A disconnect from the self, the inner self, what you think, what you believe, who you trust. You even trust yourself. And it creates a disconnect from the outer self, your relationships and behaviors. Thanks. I'm going to kind of power through these ones. I attempted to fit all of these things into one slide, and it was impossible. And so that's a testament to, when we think about trauma, really how widespread it can be. And it happens on a spectrum, or there's three kind of categories, we could say. There's disaster, there's assaults, and there's accidental or versus intentional. So as we go through all of these, start to think about with yourself or people that you know, have I maybe experienced some of this? Have I ever considered it trauma before? Again, thinking, going back to the definition of it, any event that overwhelms your ability to cope. Can we go to the next one? So we have all of these included, right? These things are kind of, I think, what people, when they think about trauma, they think, yeah, domestic violence, sexual assault, physical abuse, witnessing tough stuff falls into that, school violence. We know that. That's all over the news. People know it's traumatic. Go to the next one. Then we go into things that are more intergenerational. We talk about culturally. We talk a bigger picture. So it can start with a person, and it can expand to a lot of other things, too. This was not intentionally smaller. I don't know why that says. So also, isolation. So we see this a lot with, unfortunately, a lot with cyberbullying. We see this with children. Isolation has the same impact on the brain that physical abuse does. They've done studies, it lights up, it impacts the same part of the brain. And so we're meant to be connected socially to people. Sometimes we're not meant to be living on deserted islands by ourselves, although many of you may feel like you would like that sometimes. We need social connection. So part of trauma recovery is connecting with other people in a healthy way, reconnecting with yourself. Can you go to the next one? So here's the checkpoint that I promised. How's everybody doing? Okay. I should have passed this out before. So maybe we'll take some and go around. This is also a really interesting social experiment that I'm not doing on you, but I've seen it happen in my groups where I take one, or I take a whole pile, and people just keep passing. Nobody keeps it for themselves. So it's a testament to how you're always doing for others.
Oh, yeah.
It just keeps passing. If you need more, thank you. In the back, do you have some too? We'll talk a little bit more about how trauma impacts the brain in a really not scary way, because that sounds kind of scary. But when we experience really stressful things, all the information comes through our senses, through our smell, through physical touch, what we see, what we feel, what we hear. And any of you in the room know that if a certain thing may trigger, it could be a smell, it could be somebody looks like somebody, it could be a certain way you turn, it could be a color, whatever it is, a sound that can send somebody off reeling. So we want to use, so the senses are a great way to ground and bring yourself back to the present. Because traumatic stuff has a way of hijacking your brain. And suddenly the present is not present. And you're off somewhere else. And so this is a great way to bring back to present. So what we're going to do, what you see on here, we have 5 things you see, 4 things you feel. Physically feel. Because people sometimes are, I feel pissed off. Physically feel. 3 things you hear. 2 things you can smell. 1 thing you can taste. And so it's right here in the moment. So you don't have to say it out loud if you want, if you don't want to. So right now in this moment, picking 5 things that you see. So I see the light. Okay. 4 things you feel, physically feel. And if you need help, always start with your feet. Feel the feet. Gets a little trickier now. 3 things you hear. 2 things you smell, tricky as well, maybe like your detergent, right? 1 thing you can taste. How was that? Hard? Easy? Good?
Easy?
Champion. Good. Good. If this was easy, what you can try to do too is you start off 5, 5, 5, 4, 4, 4, 3, 2, 1 of each category. It extends it a lot further. It has to be different every time. That's the trick. Right?
Can you do the next one?
Ooh. That looks. So when we think about the, again, knowledge is power, the process of trauma is that, so we talked about, you know, an external event that overwhelms our ability to cope, right? Through no fault of our own. Sometimes people come to my office and say, well, I just can't handle it. Why? Like, I shouldn't be feeling this way. Why people have experienced perhaps much worse. Why am I feeling this way? And to which I respond, well, It's like you're saying you're going swimming and you're not going to get wet. You're going to have some response to that. Your brain's going to have some response to that. And so a traumatic event overwhelms our systems. There's usually a feeling of intense fear or helplessness or horror. And then there's a response. So this is where PTSD can come in. Not every person who has experienced something traumatic develops post-traumatic stress disorder. Is everyone familiar with that? I'm going to talk a little bit more about it in detail. I don't like the wording of it, actually. Post-traumatic stress disorder. Sounds like, I don't like it. I think it's a reordering of the brain, the way our brain responds to things to keep us safe. Kind of if you're walking through a room and you stub your toe, right? And you're like, ah, that hurts. It's a dark room, and you stub your toe. The next time you go in that room, I'm going to turn on every light. In fact, I'm going to turn on every light in the whole house because I am not doing that again. And I'm going to know where all the furniture is. And every time I sit down, I'm going to know where it is and watch my steps. Because my brain got kicked into survival mode and wants me to be safe. Now I'm talking about a stubbed toe. We all know that there's more other than that. So there's a response to that. And the numbing can be part. So I ask people a lot of the time, have you ever felt like your head was separate from your body? And it's kind of a funny question, but the people who've experienced know exactly what it is. Oh, yeah. Like you feel like you're kind of just watching yourself or you're separate from kind of this detachment. The brain is a beautiful thing in that it's going to work really, really hard to try to keep us safe and feeling okay. And if that means zoning out from reality or what's going on in the present moment, that's what it's going to do. So it's great when there's real threat, but if that's going on all the time, that's going to cause a lot of problems. That's like having your car, and I love my analogies, so there's like 10 million more. That's like having your ignition, you're sitting in the car with the ignition on, the car's in park, and your foot's on the gas. It's going to create changes in the brain, and then goes in there, and then it's going to have an impact. So what you can't see down here is four. And this is from Stephanie Cummington. Her work doing this had the honor of being able to train with her in her model of trauma recovery, which I find really, really amazing. That there'll be a retreat, so people can kind of isolate. They may develop depression. They're not connecting with other people. There can be a harm to self. So that could be substance abuse, drinking away how I feel. That could be actual harm to self, people who struggle with self-injurious behavior, cutting, things like that. Harm to others, lashing out at people, biting people's head off. Doesn't have to be straight, you're gonna punch someone in the face, although that could be included in there. So, and then the other part is a physical impact. And Dr. Petra, you probably see this often in your work in terms of the impact that trauma can have on somebody's physical body. Again, think of the car. It's going to wear out. So people have higher incidences of cardiovascular disease, fibromyalgia, tons, chronic headaches.
Can I just ask a question that I know people ask all the time?
Mm-hmm.
People come into the office and they say they can't get beyond something. Like it's like repeats
mm-hmm.
over and over and over again.
Mm-hmm.
Can you talk about maybe why that's happening?
Sure.
And what kind of strategies people can use for that, the repeating thoughts and sort of the
mm-hmm.
obsessive nature sometimes of
mm-hmm.
a trauma?
Sure. Great. It's a great question.
When it comes back at night, typically people say that when they shut their eyes and they're trying to fall asleep at
right.
night, that trauma keeps reliving over and over and over again. So I think that's a really common issue.
That's a great question. So what is happening when that, when people are experiencing, so what you're talking about are maybe flashbacks or intrusive thoughts, things, you know, that pink elephant on the bicycle, like you said, like it keeps coming back. What neurologically is happening is that that information is stuck in the right hemisphere of the brain. That's the part, that's our survival part. That's the same part where if a bear were to charge into this room right now, some of us would try to kung fu it, some of us would run away, and others may go, you know? And so when that happens, when a survival, when a traumatic event happens, the front part of the brain, our frontal lobe, that's in charge of thinking, it's in charge of planning, it's rational thought, that shuts down. Shuts down, goes offline. And that survival part of the brain kicks in. Because I need to survive. It's going to send all the blood, all the energy to our limbs to prepare to fight, flight, or freeze. And so what happens when people are having those recurring thoughts, things like that, it's because that information is stuck. And what we need to do to try to get that unstuck is be able to create new, different associations and be able to move that to the left side of the brain. So one of the types of therapy that I practice in my office is called EMDR therapy. Eye movement desensitization and reprocessing, which sounds like a big mouthful. But essentially what that does is takes that information that's been hijacked, that's stuck in trauma time, not hammer time, trauma time, I had to make that joke, that's stuck in that part of your brain and uses the brain's natural ability to move towards wellness, to move it to the left side where it needs to go, to be able to say, this happened, it happened to me, but I'm okay and I'm safe now. Because what gets people stuck and what you're describing, Christine, is that the past becomes present. And so, and I'll talk about the stages of trauma recovery too, but that first stage is creating safety, orienting yourself in the present. So the two exercises we've done so far, the breath, right, with the sound. I love the sound with it because I think just trying to breathe on your own can be really hard to follow. I know for me it is sometimes, and so I like to follow the sound. And orienting yourself with the senses, that's part of grounding. Does that answer the question?
Yeah. Can we click the next one?
So when we look at PTSD, and again, I want to emphasize too that not everybody who's experienced something traumatic or stressful develops PTSD. I think sometimes people think, well, if I don't have PTSD, then what I experience isn't important, or I shouldn't work on it, or I shouldn't talk about it. So I want to make that important. People can sometimes minimize what they've experienced, is my point. So when we look at post-traumatic stress disorder, again, the word disorder, I'm not a big fan of. But think it's, you know, you think about it's a reordering of the brain to help keep you safe. That, so here are the main points of it, or diagnostic criteria, people would say. There's a stressor. Okay. Again, a traumatic trauma is any event that overwhelms a person's ability to cope. And then there's an intrusion. So, can you silence that, please? Thanks. There can be intrusive. So this is what we're mentioning: intrusive thoughts, things coming back, flashbacks, visions of things, feeling a physical sensation. Right? There's a great, I didn't put it on your resource list, and I was thinking it on the way over, and I thought, shoot, so you can write it down. An excellent book called The Body Keeps the Score by Besser Vanderkolk.
Yeah, it's a good book.
An amazing book.
talking about how we store trauma
in
our body.
Do you think that's something that, like, that's something that anybody can read and understand? Because I know it's kind of a clinical book, but do you give it that to patients too?
Some of my clients have read it, and they felt they could connect with it. I think you take pieces that relate to you, and you and you leave the rest. So, avoidance. So you could be, you can start to avoid people, places, or things, or thoughts, reminders of the traumatic event or events. Negative changes in thoughts or moods, feeling depressed, feeling anxious, feeling really irritable. Irritability, by the way, is a symptom of depression. Sometimes people think of it, it's always like, I'm not going to get out of bed and I'm going to be crying all the time. And certainly that is a symptom of depression. But irritability is a big part of that too. Being really hypervigilant or reactive. So I know even like maybe it's residual of my own stuff, but if someone's coming around a corner and I don't see him, I'm like, you know, so being kind of really on edge. And that you're feeling this for more than a month. So you start to look at these things when you break it down. Again, knowledge is power.
And Erica, can you just talk about, because I know like we talk about post-traumatic stress disorder, but
mm-hmm.
and I think sometimes people associate that with just like sexual abuse or, you know, something really significant, but post-traumatic stress disorder.
People associate it with war a lot of times.
War, but there's smaller things that
absolutely.
Happen in people's lives that can be interpreted as being very significant
mm-hmm.
to create
mm-hmm.
A post-traumatic stress disorder. So can you speak a little bit more
sure.
about what that could be and sort
mm-hmm.
of what that sort of looks like? And certainly if you guys have any questions, you know, this we really want to create a very open space so that we can start having conversations and really start helping each other and really trying to work through some of these things. And this is a great place to kind of get several therapists all in the room together to really help,
mm-hmm.
You know, and we have our own experiences as well. So, you know, please, I want everybody to feel really comfortable here in terms of talking and sharing.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't want patients on camera. So we will not be putting anybody on camera. We'll be editing that out. It's just so you guys know.
So in terms of, so we think about trauma, you can think big T or little T. So big T, big stuff, you're talking about sexual assault, you know, violence, natural disasters, it's going to make a political joke, but, and then we think little T's, right? And I don't even like the language of that because I think that minimizes things. You could think little T's in terms of, you know, moving. I was just listening to a podcast on the way up here about moving from a different country and being an immigrant and coming here, how that can be extremely traumatic, especially if you're in your adolescence. So little T's being bullied, I would consider that a big T, actually. Think about loss.
I see you struggling, so I'm going to help you out.
Yeah, no, I'm not struggling.
It's like a soccer game. Like, my son
mm-hmm.
played a soccer game one time, and it was horrible, and he will remember that forever.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Everybody else on the team probably did quite well. For him, it was traumatic
mm-hmm.
for him. So
mm-hmm.
that's amazing. For everybody else, what are you talking about? It's just a freaking game.
Yeah.
For him,
great example.
It was tremendously traumatic.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
just things like that.
Yeah.
Like pets.
Yeah.
A hamster.
People
somebody,
betraying
yeah,
you.
Came
mm-hmm.
into work one time and said their hamster died and they needed to leave. And we're like, what?
Mm-hmm.
But for them, that was really, really important.
Yes.
Yeah.
So again, thinking about going back to the definition of anything that overwhelms your ability to cope. So that doesn't have to be huge, huge things.
yeah.
So it's creating, you know, it's rewriting the story, and there's a lot of different ways to do that in terms of treatment. You know, I spoke to the type, you know, I do EMDR. I know, Cheryl, you do a different form of trauma treatment that's also very effective. Some people may do what's called cognitive behavioral therapy, where you identify and you challenge and you replace some of those negative thoughts. So I think that takes a lot longer than some other, you have to work on a physiological level. But yeah, so rewriting the story and going from a place of maybe I felt I was helpless to I did everything that I could. Or it's my fault to everything that I could. Yeah. Or I'm not in control to I'm in control now.
You feel empowered.
Exactly. Yeah. It's taking your power back. And that's what I mean about using these things that can either deplete you and take from you, or you can take back.
So I have a question.
Sure.
I have a child who you know who had a fairly long-term childhood illness.
Mm-hmm.
And has anxiety and some other issues. And one of the things that I've found, and I don't know if anyone else has seen this with trauma, but with the curious piece of it is there's almost a comfort level with her thought process. It's as much positivity as we bring in and as much, happy thoughts and good stuff. The bottom line, what I see is there's a comfort level with this is who I am, and I can't go beyond this because this is my world. You don't understand.
Mm-hmm.
There's no possibility for me to see another way, and oftentimes won't even truly engage
mm-hmm.
with certain therapies that could.
Mm-hmm.
help her emerge
mm-hmm.
And maybe escape it. And so it's, I guess, I don't know, in a way she lives in a constant fight or flight
mm-hmm.
pattern.
Yeah.
Even visually we've seen some of that with almost like tremors in her eyes and whatnot. But I don't know, it's just it getting a person past that comfort
mm-hmm.
with
mm-hmm.
their trauma
mm-hmm.
is
mm-hmm.
it's interesting.
Well, you can identify, you can identify with it, and a lot of people, too, when we talked about military as well, like part of the recovery process is making meaning of it, and then also in mourning the loss of things, and so this becomes so integrated in who I am, without it, who am I?
Exactly.
Like, that's scary, you know, the devil you know sometimes is better than the devil that you don't know.
Right.
So that makes a lot of sense, and I think it's a very, very important point.
And there's secondary reinforcement, too.
And a lot of times, trauma, we're talking about, like, rewriting the story, right? And so knowing where that negative, identifying where that negative script is rooted, and it's usually rooted in one of three themes, three, maybe four. It will come to me if the fourth one is power and control. You know, feeling powerless, or so a theme of control, responsibility, or safety. I'm not safe, I'm going to die, medical, right? Oh my gosh, I mean, there could be so many things, right? And so to venture beyond that can trigger the opposite of that. And so knowing where it's rooted, so we can look at the behavior part of it. We think of it like a weed. And you can cut off the top of the weed and we can change some of the behaviors, but if we don't get to the root of it, it's going to keep growing back. And when you get to the root, I mean, I pull a lot of weeds because I'm a bad gardener, but when you pull up a weed, right, a lot of times it brings other weeds with it. So if we get to the root, it that says a lot. So coping skill number two, checkpoint again. Check in, refuel if you're leaning forward, if you're leaning back, how your body's feeling. So this, I do this with every single person that walks into my office, regardless of what their histories are. They should do it within the first two sessions because I think everyone can benefit. I have about five safe places. So with this, it's quick guided meditation. You can do it with your eyes closed. You can do it with your eyes open. You can do it with your eyes lowered. If they're lowered or opened, I would recommend picking a focal point if that feels okay for you. And what we're going to be doing is creating a safe place. And if safe doesn't, if that word feels foreign to you, think of, you can replace it with peaceful or calming or relaxing. So I'm going to find my chimes here. And you don't have to participate if you don't want to either. It's optional. Should have referenced that. So we'll just start with one breath, and then I'll lead us. So again, breathing in and exhale. Allow your mind to envision a safe or peaceful or calm place. This can be a place that you've been to before. It can be a place that exists in your life now. It could be a place that you'd like to go. Or it could be a place that exists in your mind. What's most important is that it is a place where you can relax, you can be at peace, you feel supported and centered. If it's hard for you to identify a place, think of the last place where you were bored. And try that out. Start to tune in to all the sensations of this place. Notice what you see, the colors, the shapes, the objects. Notice what you feel. Tune in to the sounds. Notice if there's any taste or smells. Really allow yourself to enjoy all the sensations of this place. This is your place exclusively for you. If you wish, you can invite anyone or anything to join you. You can be by yourself, whatever feels right. Start to tune in and dial in even more to the details. And if you wish to add anything more or take anything out, allow yourself to do that. Now, identify an object or a symbol to represent this place. It can be something that's tangible. It can be something completely abstract. There's no right or wrong. But identify that symbol to represent your peaceful or safe place. Look at it up close. Get really familiar with it. Notice what it looks like, what it feels like, what it sounds like. And now taking that symbol with you, starting to leave your peaceful or safe place. Know that you can come back to this place at any time, anywhere, for anything to support your healing and well-being. And we'll end the same way we began, with the breath. And when you hear the chime, opening your eyes and coming back to the present. Breathing in and exhale. So I'll invite you now to, if you wish, to quickly draw a picture of your symbol. There's a little space on there if you want, or you can draw it on the back of something. When we talk about moving things from one side of the brain to the other, this is a way to do it, by drawing. I have lots more.
So my clients, I find that they bring, I invite them to carry with them something that represents that symbol or that symbol. I always have white candles in my office. That's one of my symbols. It's white candles. So, does anyone have any comments, or I don't want to pressure people to share?
I have a quick question.
Sure.
Do you ever have difficulty getting your clients to go through imagery?
Like that?
Yeah.
Sometimes.
Where they can't find a safe place. They can't imagine the place.
Yes. Yep. That happens. So with with the type of therapy that I do for trauma recovery, EMDR, there are a couple of clients where it's really difficult for them to find that place. And I find, so we change the wording. So that's why it's like the word safe sometimes is very foreign and in it, it just doesn't exist at all. It's not even in the vocabulary. So when we say like a bored place, because that's a place where you can kind of relax. But also too, so I said, I do this in the beginning, but for some people it can take longer because the trust and the alliance and the therapeutic relationship is key. Because to do, and some people may have found that really, really challenging, right? Because to do that, there's a certain level of vulnerability that you have, even, you know, just kind of going in your mind. And so I meet them where they're at. And we talk about that, and we get there. So it may take longer for others, but not impossible. Not impossible. Yeah. I don't have any time. Any other comments or questions or? So, this, I put a portion here about relational trauma. I feel like if I can allow people to see or to know what it looks like, again, knowledge is power, and something can click, then great. So when we think about trauma, part of it is abuse. We're talking about relationships. It's any attempt to gain power and control over another person using physical, emotional, sexual, or verbal tactics. So that power and control piece is a big part of it. And it's not always the obvious. Power and control of somebody, you know, is being physically violent towards someone, that's a way to have physical power and control over somebody. But it's the emotional, it's the verbal, it's the seemingly subtle things. Those are the things that really, really have an impact as well, and I really like to draw attention to, because they're much more silent. Can we go to the next one? So we look at, so I think of this like a roll-up. So if anyone's ever known anyone, or if anyone has been in an unhealthy relationship, and it's felt like a roller coaster, like you're up, you're down, you're up and down, sometimes you may think you're going crazy. The power and control wheel is like the wheels of that roller coaster that keep it going. You know when you think you're going up the roller coaster, and it's that, gets momentum and goes. So when we look at these different aspects of it, I'll invite you to check in with yourself. And if stuff comes up, remember you have the breath, you have your card, and now you have your place. We got one more. I'm gonna squeeze in. So when we look at, we'll just start. So emotional abuse. Anyone think of any examples of emotional abuse?
Criticism.
Mm-hmm. I don't know where that came from back there. Oh, sound like a camera. Criticism, right?
Bullying.
Bullying, absolutely. Yep. Emotional abuse. Mm-hmm. Manipulation. So that's, you know, and here there's a term that I think is becoming more prevalent, but maybe not, maybe because I talk about it all the time, but it's called gaslighting. Is anyone familiar with that? Okay. So gaslighting actually started, I don't know who the playwright is, I'll have to Google it, but it was from a play, I think back in like the 30s or 40s.
Samuel Beckett.
Thank you.
Go, Michelle.
Yeah, Michelle. Was it 30s or 40s? It was a long time ago. Where in the play, there's a couple, in this particular one, it was a male and female, and the husband, there's gaslights, you know, the house is lit up by gaslights, by electricity, and he goes around, and day by day, turns them down, little by little, little by little, little by little. And the wife is like, why is it getting dark in here? Why is it getting dark in here? So, I don't know what you're talking about. He starts to make her think that she's going crazy. He's the one who's manipulating. So if you ever walk into a room feeling really confident about how you feel and you walk out thinking you're the one to blame, you've been gaslighted. Economic abuse, using money's power too, right? Keeping someone on an allowance, intimidation, a lot can be said with just a look, with body language, with size. I think of, so my daughter, she's like two feet, whatever, she's tall, she's short. And full of spice. And we had a play date recently with another 2-year-old girl who's also full of spice. And my daughter wanted to see the animals. She's like, wants to see this hedgehog. Every time we go, he never comes out of the cage. I'm always hoping that damn hedgehog comes out, never sees it. She's like, see the hedgehog. And this other little girl stands right in front of her, blocking her. And she moves around the seat. She blocks her. And everywhere she goes, she stands in front of her. And they, no words were spoken. And they stood head to head like this, just like eyeing each other down. So like it's innate in like human behavior from that early age. It's intimidation, right? She was trying to gain power and control. eventually the other girl hip checked her and then my daughter pushed her. But I tried to teach her to stand up for herself. Using children or pets. So hurting the things that are most important to you. A woman who's, or an individual who's been in an abusive relationship will always look insane outside of the context of that relationship. The other person will try to flip it around and make it look like they're cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs, when really they're responding appropriately. And so they'll use that to make them look like a bad parent. They're incapable. Using privilege, white privilege, male privilege, cultural privilege, money privilege, power. Sexual abuse, having this, you know, and especially in a relationship, that if you don't want to have sex with somebody, no is no. If you're married or you're dating or what it is, there's no like, oh, because we're married or dating, we have to. Threats. If you don't XYZ, I'll do this. If you leave me, I'm going to take all the money. If you leave me, I'm going to make sure I get the kids. If you leave me, I'm going to kill myself. I'm going to hurt myself. That's like the ultimate. Somebody, again, we all want to feel in control. We all want to feel powerful. It feels good. Right? And when somebody who's an abusive person starts to recognize that that rope is, they're starting to lose hold of that power over somebody, their motivation to regain that power goes through the roof. So if you or anybody you know is in an abusive relationship, safety planning is key. If the person knows that you're planning to leave and you just get up and leave, you're increasing your risk of serious injury. And so, and there's in resources in your packet too about that.
And one thing we've been talking about in our office recently, I don't know how many of you have teenagers here, but we've been really surprised, right, recently, sort of the amount of abuse that's happening in teenage relationships.
Yes, yeah.
So it's very disturbing. So these, and it's not always just male to female, sometimes it's female to male. So
male to male, female to female.
So it crosses a lot of borders, and you know, it's something to definitely talk to your kids about and have conversations about in terms of what's a healthy relationship, what's not. Mm-hmm. And sometimes, you know, you think about reaction formations that kids have in terms of substance abuse. You know, possibly that, you know, they've had this traumatic relationship, haven't talked to anybody about it, and then they reach out, and in order to dull those sensations, they start using substances. Mm-hmm. So it's really important to open the door and have a lot of conversations about healthy relationships and what trauma can look like, what trauma can feel like, because it is so painful. So the natural reaction is to try to reach out to a substance to numb it eventually. So, you know, so if you have kids or you just know anybody that has trauma, really talking to them about that level of pain and how to get help, and how to really try to stay away from substances, because that's just such a slippery slope, you know. And once kids feel that someone who's been trying to use heroin and abuses a really strong opiate, it's really, really tough to get them off of that. It really dulls the pain really, really well. And it's really heartbreaking to try to get them off of that. So, something to think about.
Yeah. Loveisrespect.org is a great resource for tweens and teens. Learn about healthy relationships. They have little quizzes on there. They like that. Take a quiz, kind of sneak it in there. Very, very important point. We'll go to the next one. Okay. Here's your third. Okay. So with this, it's creating a container. So a place to kind of
set aside, or big fancy word, compartmentalize things, to be able to place distressing thoughts, feelings, emotions, whatever it is, and kind of just contain it for a little bit. So again, short guided meditation. If that's struggling too, keep your, if the last one was really difficult, keep your eyes open and follow my voice, or look at your coping card, or just put your feet on the ground. So with this one, I always like the breath. You can never breathe too much, right? So with this, the breath, I want you to think of bringing something in that you need right now in this moment. So if it's peace, if it's tolerance, if it's stillness, and then with the exhale, letting go of what's not serving you right now. So breathe in what you need and exhale to let go. Begin to visualize a container that can hold any and all disturbing material. And so by container, I mean anything. It can be a safe, it can be a box, it can be a bag, it can be a jar, it can be a house, whatever makes sense to you. And by any and all disturbing material, it can be a worry, something from the past, something you're worried about the future. It can be not being present in this moment, something pulling you away. It could be a feeling. There's no right or wrong. And start to really notice the details of that container, how big it is, its shape, how thick or thin the walls are, what material it's made out of. If it has a lock. And now I'd like you to envision a sign or an inscription of sort that indicates to others to keep out or keep away, or to know that this container is for your soul use and only in the service of your healing. And just for practice, place that disturbing thing or things, if there's multiple ones, envision yourself placing those in the container. Notice how little or how much effort it takes. Perhaps you need some assistance, like a forklift or a friend. And envision closing that container. If you'd like to add any additional mechanisms, now would be a good time to do it. And taking 10 steps back. They can be big or small. Ten, nine, eight, seven, six, five, four, three, two, one. Notice what it feels like to be separate from that what is in the container. Know that you are separate from it, you are bigger than it, and that it's not inside of you. Knowing that you can come back to this container when you feel ready, and only in the service of your healing. And we'll end the same way we began. Breathing in something that you need and exhaling what no longer serves you in this moment. Big inhale and exhale. And opening your eyes or coming back to the present. How we doing? Okay? Okay? Good? Okay? Which one do you like the best so far?
I like the container.
You like the container? Yeah?
Safe place.
Safe place?
No, I don't
know. Yeah? Okay. Light stream,
no,
with the body and light stream.
Kind of other imagery that was really cool. Trauma.
I think I did the light stream. If we have time at the end, we can do it. Yeah. I like that one too. There's lots of little different ones. And you'll find that certain things may work for you sometimes and not work for you other times. So don't get discouraged. Oh, I just remembered a big thing to pass out at the end. Or information. So when I'll leave time for any questions too at the end. So when we think about trauma recovery, right? That shift from what's being deleted from your life, the person's life, to what's being added. How can we enrich it? Oh. There. So there's a lot of different literature, there's a lot of different research in terms of trauma recovery process, but pretty much across the board, this is applicable to all forms of trauma treatment that people may choose to go through. And it's in three phases. The first is safety and containment. The second is remembrance and mourning. And the third is reconnection and reintegration. Remember, trauma creates a disconnect between the self and others. And so it's about creating a connection. Tracy, I know you do grief work, and we've had some conversations about, some really good conversations about loss and the crossroads of loss and trauma. And you've always been talking to me about, you know, making new connections, not deleting, right, but adding new connections and relationships in your life. So this phase one is personal safety. So this, you know, physically. In a lot of the work that I do with people, we talk about boundaries pretty early on, physical boundaries, you know, how close or how far you feel physically from someone. I had an old boss that had like no physical boundaries and like always be in my like hug and like talk to you, right? And I was like, ugh, you know. I think I've shared this with you too, I do with my clients, my like what to do when I'm at line getting coffee if someone's in my space. So good. So practices at home and in the mirror, and then you can do it in line if you want. But you know what I'm talking about? Like you're in the checkout or you're getting coffee and someone's like right behind you, mm-hmm. and you're like, you can just feel it.
They're breathing
on you. Yes, right? So a couple things you can do. You can give the look, your eye, it's just the look, right? Or you can take a step back. You create the space.
People move, or you can do it, a combination. But start thinking about the boundaries of what feels safe and what doesn't. Grounding, so everything that we've done so far is considered grounding. You think like anxiety and stress and trauma, like you wanna come out of your own skin. Think rooting your feet and grounding, being present in the here and now, what's going on.
Can I just add a point about that? So one thing you didn't talk at all about, which, I feel like is a really important piece in terms of genuine self-care, but also grounding, is sort of active grounding. I mean, all the things that we're talking about are sort of visual and guided imagery, but I think there's a lot to be said in terms of working trauma through the body.
Mm-hmm.
So, different kinds of activities would be like a yoga practice.
Absolutely.
Which, I do a mindfulness class that incorporates some light yoga into the practice. I feel like that's very important. Even sometimes I'll have people, I have weights in my office and I have kettlebells in my office, and I'll actually have people lift the weights up over their head. And, as you do that, your feet are literally grounding into the ground. So it creates, a strength and, a lift in your spirit. Even when you open up your body and you open your stance more, you feel more powerful and grounded. So I think, really thinking about the body also as a way, as a vehicle for working through trauma and not just the mind. I think there's so many ways to actively work trauma through and to ground and to feel safe. And even Michelle, who's also a psychologist in our practice, is an incredible Krav Maga, amazing warrior person. And I mean, I imagine that's very grounding, and that feels very strength forming for you to be able to protect yourself and to be able to defend yourself, right? Mm-hmm. Especially for victims that have had some kind of sexual abuse or who feel, victimized, to be able to fight back and to be able to really defend yourself if need be. So there are, it doesn't need to be just in your head that we can, there are other ways. And I do think building strength in the body and exercise and really finding things that give you that lift and the endorphins and sort of the peace within yourself. I think there's a lot of body practices that go along with this as well.
Mm-hmm. And part of that, is feeling safe in your body. So going to yoga immediately without that could be very triggering for somebody. And so some of the things that I do with my clients, talking about physical grounding, is just to really just feel, right? A lot of times we don't, you can be so numb and disconnected. My favorite is to, so everyone go like this. Get it really warm. And then, do it a lot of different areas. I like to do it on my eyes or back here. We hold a lot of tension right here, right? And so part of this is to talk about genuine self-care, making your health a priority, taking time for yourself. Go to the next one. We're gonna have time. H2. So we're talking about rewriting the narrative, right? So we can talk about things, different forms of treatment that I mentioned, and starting to letting go of some stuff and honoring that and holding a place for that and working through that. Okay, thanks. And then the last one, reconnecting. Tree of Life is one of my favorite. I don't have any tattoos, but if I get a tattoo, it would be the Tree of Life. I think I'm past the time to get a tattoo, probably. Reconnection. A renewed sense of self. I am not the trauma. It's no longer the central line in my life. Meaning making. How can I use this to strengthen me? Engaging in healthy relationships, letting go the ones that no longer serve you, that are abusive, and living a life worth living. Getting to the point where you're not suffering every day. Being in the moment, reconnecting with yourself, loving yourself in the process that you're in. I had to put the flip side of this. So we have like the power and control wheel, which is like, ooh, like looming over. And when I look at it, I'm like, meh. Right? People say, okay, well, I know what it doesn't, what an unhealthy relationship or an abusive relationship looks like. Well, what's the other side? That's like, okay, my car's not running well. I've broken down on the side of the highway. You tell me that I need a new belt, but if I don't get a new belt, guess what? Your car ain't driving. So knowing what's causing issues, but then the next step, what is healing moving forward look like? So in healthy relationships, every relationship is built upon, you can really hone this down, four things, four pillars: respect, responsibility, honesty, and trust. Think of how many, and they're all interconnected, think of how many people who aren't honest do you trust? How many people who aren't responsible for their own feelings, thoughts, and beliefs do you have respect for? Oh, well, you make me so mad, that's why I do these things. You should know better, this is how I am. Respect, responsibility, honesty, trust. And I drive my husband crazy because, you know, if we're in an argument, not argument, but a tiff over wet, he always leaves wet towels on the phone or on the floor. If you're watching on Twitter, yes. And it's never about the towel, it's never about the burnt casserole. It's never about where did I misplace my phone. Usually there's respect, responsibility, honesty, or trust. Something is being compromised there. In this case, it's responsibility, right? Good guy. Go to the next one. So I added this part because we've talked about it. So what now? There could be a lot more on here too. If today you're thinking, okay, like what's next for me? If you're saying, oh, I think I'm in an abusive relationship, there's tons of resources in the packet that I gave you. If you're looking to work with a therapist, somebody who's trained in trauma recovery, very important. Joining support groups, finding people that you can connect with as well, also in the resources. And there's different forms of treatment if people are looking. So I mentioned EMDR, that's cognitive behavioral therapy, all these acronyms, right? And a new up-and-coming one, accelerated resolution therapy, which I'm learning. Have you heard of it?
I work with someone who does it.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. I think it's the next EMDR.
Well, it's EMDR on steroids,
actually. Yes, that's what it is. That's what it is. So that's
good stuff.
Yeah, there's not enough research to like, but EMDR started that way.
Well, the woman who created it was doing EMDR wrong, supposedly.
Ah.
And her mentor said, that's not EMDR. And
yeah, she's like, well,
she was getting incredible results.
Yeah. So there's a lot of help out there. And knowing that you don't have to go it alone. And one of the things that prevents people from reaching out is maybe a sense of shame or guilt. And the biggest, Brené Brown does research on shame and guilt. And she says the biggest antidote to shame is self-empathy. And talking about it. Because once you get it out there, it's a lot less energy in here. And with people that you trust. So, these are my dogs. It's kind of cheesy, but I love it. So when I is replaced with we, even illness transforms to wellness. And I think that attests to you know, part of, again, that disconnect and not feeling isolated and connecting with the appropriate supports and knowing that you don't have to go it alone.
Can I just make one point about that? So I think a really important point to think about, and I say this to people all the time that come in, is that, you know, when we think about people that build a lot of strength and resilience and are really powerful people, right? And people that we look up to, those are people who have been through the absolute worst of the worst. They've been through shit storms, right? And they've come out alive and they've built strength.
Mm-hmm.
Do not build strength, even when you think about the physical building of strength, when you think about training and you think about, I do a lot of athletics, so when you think about, you know, lifting weights and developing yourself physically, you need to tear the muscle apart to rebuild a muscle to get stronger. It's the same thing with trauma, that trauma or these experiences that we have, these things that we have been given for whatever reason, it's an opportunity to take it and to burn it down and rebuild. You know, and I always think about the symbol of the phoenix, you know, that they rise from the ashes. You know, when you think about any sort of mythological figure, or I don't know if you guys watch Game of Thrones, like, which I'm a big Game of Thrones person, or, you know, Khaleesi. And, I mean, these people are stripped away of everything, right? And they build themselves back up again. We know that as humans within our souls, that's what we need to do, and that's how we build ourselves. So having trauma and being given these experiences, it sucks, and it can suck the life out of you. But if you can try with anything to try to get on top of it, to try to rebuild, you will become stronger and more capable of doing things than you've ever, ever imagined.
And become a very empathic person.
You become a very empathic person, a very intuitive person. You become a very spiritual person. You become a more human person. That is our humanity. So, you know, thinking about trauma and thinking about it differently, in that it is something that we've been given, and it's something that we are going to work through, and we are going to rebuild a stronger person out of it. And that's what we do in our practice. And I tell people that all the time that come in and tell me these incredible stories of stuff that's happened to them. You know, and even with kids, too, they understand, we all understand within ourselves that we love and respect people who get through this stuff. You know, and so I think giving people hope and giving people an idea that there is something beyond it, and the something beyond it is grander than anything you've ever imagined. And you will turn yourself into a different person and be able to do things you never thought you would be able to do. We all know that. We all know that deep down. So hold on to that and give that to yourself and give it to other people that need to hear that.
Well, well stated. It's a good ending for that. So, did we meet the goals for today? Any questions or feedback or?
Erica, what would you say are your top two strategies for someone who's in a lot of distress? So in the moment, they're having a flashback or they're having a lot of intrusive thoughts. What would you suggest as like the top two things?
So the top two things, so one is kind of funny. So like in session, one's kind of funny, but it works every time. And the other one is like my power play one. So the first one is thinking about, we want to get stuff into the thinking part of the brain. I don't have a pillow here, but if I had a pillow, we'll toss a pillow back and forth, and we do an alphabet game. So I'll let them choose. Usually it's always animals as the category. So I'll say, you know, ape, bear, cat, dog, and we go all through the alphabet. So it seems kind of silly, but it grounds just like that. So you can do that too in your head. I'm going to give each of you a packet that has a whole list of grounding skills broken down into mental,
physical and emotional. And so that's one. The second is the power play, I call. And it's the four elements. So you think earth, air, water, fire. Earth, ground your feet. Earth, and we're there. So I always make eye contact. So if you're not with somebody, right, pick something to focus on. Feeling your feet on the ground, taking off your shoes. Can be even just the action of taking off your shoes will get you into your left brain. So earth, air, the breath, breathe. Water, taking a sip of water, getting the saliva going in your mouth. The reasoning behind that is when we go into fight, flight, or freeze mode, our digestive system shuts down. You don't got to worry about digesting the cheeseburger if you're running from, if you're in survival mode. And now you may not be an actual threat, but your brain doesn't know the difference. And so when you get the saliva going, it sends the signals that, oh, I can rest and digest, because saliva breaks down our food, allows us to digest it. So feel your feet, breathe, get a drink of water, I always recommend people carry mints with themselves or water. Should be drinking water anyways. And then fire. So with that, kind of igniting your imagination, go to your safe place or your peaceful place. We don't have time for the last thing, but do the container, whatever it is. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
For being here. I hope you can come back.